In February of 1985, the Bio Booster Armor Guyver burst into the scenes in Tokusha Shoton's monthly Shonen Captain magazine. Hello YouTube, Alkanphel here, and today I will be bringing you episode 1 of The Guyver Explained. Kyoshoku Soko Guyver, as it's known in Japan, please excuse my poor Japanese pronunciation, is a 30-year-old manga series that is still running today and is currently being serialized in Kadowaka's monthly Shonen Ace magazine. It's a sci-fi action-adventure series created, written, and drawn by Yoshiki Takaya, and it revolves around the Guyver, a symbiotic biological booster armor of avian origin. Currently there are 31 volumes of the manga, and it's spawned two anime OVAs, one being movie length, and the other being a 12-part series. There have also been two live-action movies, and more recently a 26-episode series covering the first 10 volumes of the manga. Later in this series, I will cover each of these releases in depth, but in this episode, I'm just going to try to fill you in on the history and the story up to the current point. So the main protagonist is Sho Fukamachi, a 17-year-old high school student who accidentally stumbles upon one of the Guyver units after hearing a distant explosion whilst out walking with his friend Tetsuo Sagawa. The Unit G envelops him and transforms him into a Guyver. At the same moment, a paramilitary unit with what appears to be a monster arrive in the area. They're looking for this unit, but they have no idea that the being they see before them is a fully realized Guyver. They explain that they work for a shadow organization by the name of Kronos, and that they can produce these monsters, which they refer to as Zoonoids. The Zoonoid attempts to physically coerce the boys into revealing what they know. However, at this point, Sho is still not conscious after his transformation, and the Guyver is in what becomes known as auto-defense mode. It quickly makes short work of the Zoonoid. The remaining Kronos troops flee, and they report their encounter to the Japanese Kronos branch director, Genzo Makashima. Now, as the story unfolds, Sho learns the secrets of the Guyver, and valiantly battles against the evil Kronos Corporation to protect his friends, family, and love interest, Mizuki Sagawa. We learn that there are in fact three such units on Earth, and that they are of ancient alien design. Due to being the first person that Kronos knows of activating a unit, the Sho is from then referred to as Guyver 1. The second unit is activated by a Kronos inspector by the name of Liska, and the third by a schoolmate of Sho's, Agito Makashima, the son of Genzo Makashima, the Kronos Japan branch director. Now, Guyver 2 is defeated by Fukamachi, and though he lacked the combat training Liska had, he still won, and this was due to the fact that Liska's control medal was damaged in the initial explosion that sent the first unit flying towards Sho. The control medal is essentially the CPU of the Guyver, and it directly interfaces with the host's brain. If it can no longer regulate the power supplied by the Guyver, the unit ends up consuming the host. I will cover the control medal and all of the Guyver's weaponry in a subsequent episode in the series, so don't be too worried about that at the moment. And Guyver 2 does make a reappearance later in the manga series as the only female Guyver. Again, I will cover this in a later episode I do about the Guyvers and their armaments. Now, Guyver 3, who's often referred to as the Dark Guyver due to his black and red color scheme, is a pretty enigmatic character. His true motivations are only revealed later in the series, and even though he allies himself with Guyver 1 on occasion, it's pretty obvious he has his own agenda. Now, as the story progresses, we learn that Kronos is actually a worldwide organization that has infiltrated almost every facet of human society, and their goal is nothing less than total world domination. They are well-funded, organized, and led by the 12 Holy Commanders. Now, this Council of 12 is chaired by an individual by the name of Alkanphel. That's right, now you all know where I got this tag from, and I've been using it in online gaming for at least 15 years now. Anyway, I digress. So these 12 Holy Commanders are also referred to as Zoa Lords. They're not only much stronger than a Guyver, but they can also telepathically control Zoonoids and their stronger variants, hyperzoonoids. Again, I will do an in-depth episode on zoonoids, hyperzoonoids, and zoolords. So, don't worry if you don't know what I'm talking about just yet. Right, the Guyvers, then they proceed to do the, you know, their best to battle these forces. However, the unthinkable actually happens as the series is progressing. Cronus do actually take over the world. In one day, governments are toppled and militaries are crushed. And we learn that Cronus discovered how to make these zoonoids after an archaeological dig in which they found an ancient spaceship. And this is also where the three Guyver units were found. Now, this wasn't dumb luck, however. It was all engineered by their enigmatic leader, Alkanphel, the Supreme Commander. Later in the series, we learn that at the dawn of creation, the gods arrived on planet Earth. Now, these gods were in fact aliens that became known as the Advents, or the Creators, although they called themselves Uranios. No record of their physical form remains, and we only know what the spaceship reveals about them and what Alkanphel remembers, and I'll elaborate on that in just a moment. I mean, it's revealed that the Uranios came to this planet to engineer biological weapons to fight in some great cosmic war, and for 250 million years they experimented until a basic bioweapon model was perfected, a living construct of the Creator's will. That weapon, that construct, exists still, and it is humanity itself. Now, the zoonoids were humans that were improved for fighting by creating massive variations at the genetic level over a short period of time. Zoonoids were those humans that were able to transform themselves into the second phase, to alter themselves into highly efficient fighters with tremendous strength. Various different zoonoids were created for different purposes. They created the first Zoolord, Alkanphel, to be their battle general. They would command him, and he would command the legions of zoonoids. And Alkanphel dearly loved his creators and served them diligently. However, mankind was destined to never enter the cosmic battle. The creators abruptly left Earth, and for a long time it wasn't unveiled why they left. But this happened because one of their experiments actually went out of control. I mean, they wondered what would happen if they bonded the everyday armor that they all wore with one of these new weapons they had created. So they tried it out, being curious, and, well, the results terrified them. The bio-boosted human not only had his strength amplified by over 100 times, but also gained several new abilities, such as the Mega Smasher, Sonic Blades, etc. The bio-boosted human was also free of the mental control of both the Zoolord and the Creators, and when ordered to remove the unit, the human refused and destroyed one of the alien spaceships before being subdued. The Uranios called this being Guyver, in their language simply meaning out of control. This individual would later be referred to as Guyver Zero. As they evacuated Earth, Alkanphel begged them not to leave. However, they explained that a Guyver was stronger than they, and with no telepathic control over it, they could not risk having another human bond with the unit. They summoned a huge asteroid and hurled it at the Earth as they left, to cleanse the planet. In his grief and his rage, Alkanphel summoned all of his energies and ploughed headfirst into the asteroid. It exploded into many smaller pieces that impacted the planet and brought about a nuclear winter and the first ice age. This totally drained Alkanphel, and his limp body fell to the Earth, and he was in a comatose state. At that point, the locals had seen what was going on in the skies above them, and they rushed to his limp body, and they built up a shrine around him, which eventually became a huge pyramid, and that pyramid was revealed to be on the island of Silha, which then became his sanctuary island. Now, thousands of years passed, and the remaining zoonoids soon interbred with the remaining humans, and the zoonoid gene became dormant, with rare occurrences mentioned in myths and folktales as monsters. You know, you get things like the Hydra and the Minotaur and stuff. And Alkanphel and his sacrifice were forgotten in the pages of history. Until 400 years ago, when a mysterious visitor washed up on the shores of Sylvar. Okay, that's it for this video. I hope you enjoyed it, and I'll be back with part 2 as soon as possible. Peace!